This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. The International Red Cross and Red Crescent Movement is an international humanitarian movement with approximately 97 million volunteers, members and staff worldwide, which was founded to protect human life and health, to ensure respect for all human beings, and to prevent and alleviate human suffering. The movement consists of several distinct organizations that are legally independent from each other, but are united within the movement through common basic principles, objectives, symbols, statutes and governing organizations. The movement's parts are: the International Committee of the Red Cross. ICRC is a private humanitarian institution founded in 1863 in Geneva, Switzerland, by Henry Dunant and Gustave Meunier. Its 25-member committee has a unique authority under international humanitarian law to protect the life and dignity of the victims of international and internal armed conflicts. The ICRC was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize on three occasions in 1917, 1944 and 1963. The International Federation of Red Cross and Red Crescent Societies IFRC was founded in 1919, and today it coordinates activities between the 188 National Red Cross and Red Crescent Societies within the movement on an international level. The Federation leads and organizes, in close cooperation with the National Societies, relief assistance missions responding to large-scale emergencies. The International Federation Secretariat is based in Geneva, Switzerland. In 1963, the Federation, then known as the League of Red Cross Societies, was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize jointly with the ICRC. National Red Cross and Red Crescent Societies exist in nearly every country in the world. Currently, 189 national societies are recognized by the ICRC and admitted as full members of the Federation. Each entity works in its home country according to the principles of international humanitarian law and the statutes of the international movement. Depending on their specific circumstances and capacities, national societies can take on additional humanitarian tasks that are not directly defined by international humanitarian law or the mandates of the international movement. In many countries, they are tightly linked to the respective national health care system by providing emergency medical services. Contents: 1. History of the movement. 11. The International Committee of the Red Cross. 111. Sol Farina, Jean-Henri Dunant and the foundation of the ICRC. 112. The ICRC during World War I. 113. The ICRC in World War II. 114. The ICRC after World War II. 115. Afghanistan. 12. The International Federation of Red Cross and Red Crescent Societies IFRC. 121. History. 122. Presidents of the IFRC. 2. Activities. 21. Organization of the movement. 22. Fundamental principles of the International Red Cross and Red Crescent movement. 23. Activities and organization of the International Conference and the Standing Commission. 24. Activities and organization of the ICRC. 241. The mission of the ICRC and its responsibilities within the movement. 242. Legal status and organization. 243. Funding and financial matters. 25. Activities and organization of the International Federation. 251. The mission of the IFRC and its responsibilities within the movement. 252. Legal status and organization. 253. Funding and financial matters. 26. National societies within the movement. 261. Official recognition of a national society. 262. Activities of national societies on a national and international stage. 3. History of the emblems. 31. Emblems in use. 311. The Red Cross. 312. The Red Crescent. 313. The Red Crystal. 32. Recognized emblems in disuse. 321. The Red Lion and Sun. 33. Unrecognized emblems. 331. The Red Star of David. Megan David Adam. 4. 1996 hostage crisis allegations. 5. See also. 6. References. 7. Further reading. 71. Books. 72. Journal articles. 8. External links. History of the movement. This section needs additional citations for verification. Please help improve this article by adding citations to reliable sources. Unsourced material may be challenged and removed. August 2012. Learn how and when to remove this template message. The International Committee of the Red Cross. Sol Farina, Jean-Henri Dunant and the foundation of the ICRC. Jean-Henri Dunant, author of A Memory of Sol Farina. Until the middle of the 19th century, there were no organized and/or well-established army nursing systems for casualties and no safe and protected institutions to accommodate and treat those who were wounded on the battlefield in June 1859. The Swiss businessman Jean-Henri Dunant traveled to Italy to meet French Emperor Napoleon III with the intention of discussing difficulties in conducting business in Algeria, at that time occupied by France when he arrived. In the small town of Solferino on the evening of June 24, he toured the field of the Battle of Solferino, an engagement in the Austro-Sardinian War in a single day. About 40,000 soldiers on both sides died or were left wounded on the field. Jean-Henri Dunant was shocked by the terrible aftermath of the battle, the suffering of the wounded soldiers, and the near-total lack of medical attendance and basic care. He completely abandoned the original intent of his trip, and for several days he devoted himself to helping with the treatment and care for the wounded. He succeeded in organizing an overwhelming level of relief assistance by motivating the local villagers to aid without discrimination. Original document of the First Geneva Convention, 1864. Back in his home in Geneva, he decided to write a book entitled A Memory of Solferino, which he published with his own money in 1862. He sent copies of the book to leading political and military figures throughout Europe, in addition to penning a vivid description of his experiences in Solferino in 1859. He explicitly advocated the formation of national voluntary relief organizations to help nurse wounded soldiers in the case of war. In addition, he called for the development of international treaties to guarantee the protection of neutral medics and field hospitals for soldiers wounded on the battlefield in 1863. Gustave Meunier, a Geneva lawyer and president of the Geneva Society for Public Welfare, received a copy of Dunant's book and introduced it for discussion at a meeting of that society. As a result of this initial discussion, the society established an investigatory commission to examine the feasibility of Dunant's suggestions and eventually to organize an international conference about their possible implementation. The members of this committee, which has subsequently been referred to as the Committee of the Five, aside from Dunant and Meunier, were physician Louis Appia, who had significant experience working as a field surgeon, Appia's friend and colleague Théodore Manouar, from the Geneva Hygiene and Health Commission, and Guillaume-Henri Dufour, a Swiss army general of great renown. 8 days later, the five men decided to rename the committee to the International Committee for Relief to the Wounded. In October 26-29-1863, the international conference organized by the committee was held in Geneva to develop possible measures to improve medical services on the battlefield. The conference was attended by 36 individuals, 18 official delegates from national governments, 6 delegates from other non-governmental organizations, 7 non-official foreign delegates, and the 5 members of the international committee. The states and kingdoms represented by official delegates were, after the Battle of Gravelotte during the Franco-Prussian War in 1870, France Electorate of Hesse. Field, namely a white armlet bearing a Red Cross memorial commemorating the first use of the Red Cross symbol in an armed conflict during the Battle of Dybbol, Denmark in 1864, jointly erected in 1989 by the National Red Cross Societies of Denmark and Germany. A Red Cross nurse, Theodor Grust, late 19th, early 20th century. Only 1 year later, the Swiss government invited the governments of all European countries, as well as the United States, Brazil, and Mexico, to attend an official diplomatic conference. 16 countries sent a total of 26 delegates to Geneva on August 22, 1864. The conference adopted the First Geneva Convention for the amelioration of the condition of the wounded in armies in the field. Representatives of 12 states and kingdoms signed the convention: Baden, Belgium, Denmark, France, Hesse, Italy, the Netherlands, Portugal, Prussia, Switzerland, Spain, and Württemberg. The convention contained 10 articles, establishing for the first time legally binding rules guaranteeing neutrality and protection for wounded soldiers, field medical personnel, and specific humanitarian institutions in an armed conflict. Furthermore, the convention defined 2 specific requirements for recognition of a national relief society by the International Committee. The national society must be recognized by its own national government as a relief society according to the convention. The national government of the respective country must be a state party to the Geneva Convention. Directly following the establishment of the Geneva Convention, the first national societies were founded in Belgium, Denmark, France, Oldenburg, Prussia, Spain, and Württemberg. Also in 1864, Louis Appia and Charles van de Velde, a captain of the Dutch army, became the first independent and neutral delegates to work under the symbol of the Red Cross in an armed conflict. 3 years later, in 1867, the first international conference Conference of National Aid Societies for the Nursing of the War Wounded was convened also in 1867. Jean-Henri Dunant was forced to declare bankruptcy due to business failures in Algeria, partly because he had neglected his business interests during his tireless activities for the International Committee controversy surrounding Dunant's business dealings and the resulting negative public opinion, combined with an ongoing conflict with Gustave Moynier, led to Dunant's expulsion from his position as a member and secretary. He was charged with fraudulent bankruptcy and a warrant for his arrest was issued. Thus, he was forced to leave Geneva and never returned to his home city in the following years. National societies were founded in nearly every country in Europe. The project resonated well with patriotic sentiments that were on the rise in the late 19th century, and national societies were often encouraged as signifiers of national moral superiority. In 1876, the committee adopted the name International Committee of the Red Cross (ICRC), which is still its official designation today. 5 years later, the American Red Cross was founded through the efforts of Clara Barton. More and more countries signed the Geneva Convention and began to respect it in practice during armed conflicts. In a rather short period of time, the Red Cross gained huge momentum as an internationally respected movement, and the national societies became increasingly popular as a venue for volunteer work. When the first Nobel Peace Prize was awarded in 1901, the Norwegian Nobel Committee opted to give it jointly to Jean-Henri Dunant and Frederic Passy, a leading international pacifist more significant than the honor of the prize itself. The official congratulation from the International Committee of the Red Cross marked the overdue rehabilitation of Jean-Henri Dunant and represented a tribute to his key role in the formation of the Red Cross. Dunant died 9 years later in the small Swiss health resort of Heiden. Only 2 months earlier, his long-standing adversary Gustave Moynier had also died, leaving a mark in the history of the committee as its longest-serving president ever. In 1906, the 1864 Geneva Convention was revised for the first time 1 year later. The Hague Convention X, adopted at the Second International Peace Conference in The Hague, extended the scope of the Geneva Convention to naval warfare shortly before the beginning of the First World War in 1914, 50 years after the foundation of the ICRC and the adoption of the First Geneva Convention. There were already 45 national relief societies throughout the world. The movement had extended itself beyond Europe and North America to Central and South America. Argentina, Brazil, Chile, Cuba, Mexico, Peru, El Salvador, Uruguay, Venezuela, Asia, the Republic of China, Japan, Korea, Siam, and Africa. Union of South Africa. The ICRC during World War I. French postcard celebrating the role of Red Cross nurses during the First World War, 1915. Ernest Hemingway in uniform as a Red Cross ambulance driver. With the outbreak of World War I, the ICRC found itself confronted with enormous challenges that it could handle only by working closely with the National Red Cross Society's Red Cross nurses from around the world, including the United States and Japan, came to support the medical services of the armed forces of the European countries involved in the war. On October 15, 1914, immediately after the start of the war, the ICRC set up its International Prisoners of War POW agency, which had about 1,200 mostly volunteer staff members by the end of 1914. By the end of the war, the agency had transferred about 20 million letters and messages, 19 million parcels, and about 18 million Swiss francs in monetary donations to POWs of all affected countries. Furthermore, due to the intervention of the agency, about 200,000 prisoners were exchanged between the warring parties, released from captivity, and returned to their home country. The organizational card index of the agency accumulated about 7 million records from 1914 to 1923, each card representing an individual prisoner or missing person. The card index led to the identification of about 2 million POWs and the ability to contact their families. The complete index is on loan today from the ICRC to the International Red Cross and Red Crescent Museum in Geneva. The right to access the index is still strictly restricted to the ICRC French war casualty wearing a prosthetic mask provided by the American Red Cross. 1918, the same man without his mask during the entire war. The ICRC monitored warring parties' compliance with the Geneva Conventions of the 1907 revision and forwarded complaints about violations to the respective country when chemical weapons were used in this war for the first time in history. The ICRC vigorously protested against this new type of warfare even without having a mandate from the Geneva Conventions. The ICRC tried to ameliorate the suffering of civil populations in territories that were officially designated as occupied territories, the ICRC could assist the civilian population on the basis of the Hague Conventions, Laws and Customs of War on Land of 1907. This convention was also the legal basis for the ICRC's work for prisoners of war, in addition to the work of the International Prisoner of War Agency as described above. This included inspection visits to POW camps. A total of 524 camps throughout Europe were visited by 41 delegates from the ICRC until the end of the war between 1916 and 1918. The ICRC published a number of postcards with scenes from the POW camps. The pictures showed the prisoners in day-to-day activities such as the distribution of letters from home. The intention of the ICRC was to provide the families of the prisoners with some hope and solace and to alleviate their uncertainties about the fate of their loved ones after the end of the war. The ICRC organized the return of about 420,000 prisoners to their home countries in 1920. The task of repatriation was handed over to the newly founded League of Nations, which appointed the Norwegian diplomat and scientist Fridtjof Nansen as its High Commissioner for Repatriation of the War Prisoners. His legal mandate was later extended to support and care for war refugees and displaced persons when his office became that of the League of Nations High Commissioner for Refugees. Nansen, who invented the Nansen passport for stateless refugees and was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize in 1922, appointed two delegates from the ICRC as his deputies a year before the end of the war. The ICRC received the 1917 Nobel Peace Prize for its outstanding wartime work. It was the only Nobel Peace Prize awarded in the period from 1914 to 1918. In 1923, the International Committee of the Red Cross adopted a change in its policy regarding the selection of new members. Until then, only citizens from the city of Geneva could serve in the committee. This limitation was expanded to include Swiss citizens as a direct consequence of World War I. An additional protocol to the Geneva Convention was adopted in 1925, which outlawed the use of suffocating or poisonous gases and biological agents as weapons. 4 years later, the original convention was revised and the Second Geneva Convention relative to the treatment of prisoners of war was established. The events of World War I and the respective activities of the ICRC significantly increased the reputation and authority of the committee among the international community and led to an extension of its competencies as early as in 1934. A draft proposal for an additional convention for the protection of the civil population during an armed conflict was adopted by the International Red Cross Conference. Unfortunately, most governments had little interest in implementing this convention, and it was thus prevented from entering into force before the beginning of World War II. The ICRC and World War II Red Cross message from Lodz, Poland, 1940. The legal basis of the work of the ICRC during World War II were the Geneva Conventions. In their 1929 revision, the activities of the committee were similar to those during World War I, visiting and monitoring POW camps, organizing relief assistance for civilian populations, and administering the exchange of messages regarding prisoners and missing persons. By the end of the war, 179 delegates had conducted 12,750 visits to POW camps in 41 countries. The Central Information Agency on Prisoners of War, Zentralauskunftsstelle für Kriegsgefangene, had a staff of 3,000. The card index tracking prisoners contained 45 million cards, and 120 million messages were exchanged by the agency. One major obstacle was that the Nazi control German Red Cross refused to cooperate with the Geneva Statutes, including blatant violations such as the deportation of Jews from Germany and the mass murders conducted in the Nazi concentration camps. Moreover, two other main parties to the conflict, the Soviet Union and Japan, were not party to the 1929 Geneva Conventions and were not legally required to follow the rules of the conventions. During the war, the ICRC was unable to obtain an agreement with Nazi Germany about the treatment of detainees in concentration camps, and it eventually abandoned applying pressure in order to avoid disrupting its work with POWs. The ICRC was also unable to obtain a response to reliable information about the extermination camps and the mass killing of European Jews. Roma, et al. After November 1943, the ICRC achieved permission to send parcels to concentration camp detainees with known names and locations because the notices of receipt for these parcels were often signed by other inmates. The ICRC managed to register the identities of about about 105,000 detainees in the concentration camps and delivered about 11 million parcels, primarily to the camps Dachau, Buchenwald, Ravensbrück, and Sachsenhausen. It is known that Swiss Army officer Maurice Rossel during World War II had been sent to Berlin as a delegate of the International Red Cross. As such, he visited Auschwitz 1943 and the Resienstadt 1944. Claude Lanzmann recorded his experiences in 1979, producing a documentary entitled Visitor from the Living. Marcel Junod, delegate of the ICRC, visiting POWs in Germany on March 12, 1945, ICRC President Jacob Burckhardt received a message from SS General Ernst Kaltenbrunner accepting the ICRC's demand to allow delegates to visit the concentration camps. This agreement was bound by the condition that these delegates would have to stay in the camps until the end of the war. 10 delegates, among them Louis Hafliger Camp Mauthausen, Paul Dunant Camp the Resienstadt, and Victor Maurer Camp Dachau, accepted the assignment and visited the camps. Louis Hafliger prevented the forceful eviction or blasting of Mauthausen-Gusen by alerting American troops, thereby saving the lives of about 60,000 inmates. His actions were condemned by the ICRC because they were deemed as acting unduly on his own authority and risking the ICRC's neutrality. Only in 1990, his reputation was finally rehabilitated by ICRC President Cornelio Samaruga. Another example of great humanitarian spirit was Friedrich Born, 1903-1963, an ICRC delegate in Budapest who saved the lives of about 11,000 to 15,000 Jewish people in Hungary. Marcel Junod, 1904-1961, a physician from Geneva, was another famous delegate during the Second World War. An account of his experiences, which included being one of the first foreigners to visit Hiroshima after the atomic bomb was dropped, can be found in the book Warrior Without Weapons. In 1944, the ICRC received its second Nobel Peace Prize. In World War I, it received the only peace prize awarded during the main period of war, 1939-1945. At the end of the war, the ICRC worked with National Red Cross societies to organize relief assistance to those countries most severely affected. In 1948, the committee published a report reviewing its war-era activities from September 1, 1939 to June 30, 1947. Since January 1996, the ICRC archive for this period has been open to academic and public research. The ICRC. After World War II, the ICRC headquarters in Geneva on August 12, 1949. Further revisions to the existing two Geneva Conventions were adopted. An additional convention for the amelioration of the condition of wounded, sick, and shipwrecked members of armed forces at sea, now called the Second Geneva Convention, was brought under the Geneva Convention umbrella as a successor to the 1907 Hague Convention. The 1929 Geneva Convention, relative to the treatment of prisoners of war, may have been the Second Geneva Convention from a historical point of view because it was actually formulated in Geneva, but after 1949 it came to be called the Third Convention because it came later chronologically than the Hague Convention, reacting to the experience of World War II. The Fourth Geneva Convention, a new convention relative to the protection of civilian persons in time of war, was established also. The additional protocols of June 8, 1977 were intended to make the conventions apply to internal conflicts such as civil wars today. The four conventions and their added protocols contain more than 600 articles, a remarkable expansion when compared to the mere 10 articles in the first 1864 convention in celebration of its centennial in 1963. The ICRC, together with the League of Red Cross Societies, received its third Nobel Peace Prize since 1993. Non-Swiss individuals have been allowed to serve as committee delegates abroad, a task which was previously restricted to Swiss citizens. Indeed, since then, the share of staff without Swiss citizenship has increased to about 35%. On October 16, 1990, the UN General Assembly decided to grant the ICRC observer status for its assembly sessions and subcommittee meetings, the first observer status given to a private organization. The resolution was jointly proposed by 138 member states and introduced by the Italian ambassador, Vieri Traxler, in memory of the organization's origins in the Battle of Solferino. An agreement with the Swiss government signed on March 19, 1990, 1993, affirmed the already long-standing policy of full independence of the committee from any possible interference by Switzerland. The agreement protects the full sanctity of all ICRC property in Switzerland, including its headquarters and archive, grants members and staff legal immunity, exempts the ICRC from all taxes and fees, guarantees the protected and duty-free transfer of goods, services, and money, provides the ICRC with secure communication privileges at the same level as foreign embassies, and simplifies committee travel in and out of Switzerland. At the end of the Cold War, the ICRC's work actually became more dangerous in the 1990s. More delegates lost their lives than at any point in its history, especially when working in local and internal armed conflicts. These incidents often demonstrated a lack of respect for the rules of the Geneva Conventions and their protection symbols. Among the slain delegates were Frederick Maurice. He died on May 19, 1992 at the age of 39, one day after a Red Cross transport he was escorting was attacked in the Bosnian city of Sarajevo. Fernanda Collado, Spain, Ingeborg Foss, Norway, Nancy Malloy, Canada, Gunhild Miklebust, Norway, Cheryl Thayer, New Zealand, and Hans Elkerbout, Netherlands. They were murdered at point blank range while sleeping in the early hours of December 17, 1996 in the ICRC Field Hospital in the Chechen city of Nowyj Otagi near Grozny. Their murderers have never been caught and there was no apparent motive for the killings. Rita Fox, Switzerland, Veronique Saro, Democratic Republic of Congo, formerly Zaire, Julio Delgado, Colombia, Unan Euphorworth, DR Congo, Adu Boboli, DR Congo, and Jean Molikabong, DR Congo. On April 26, 2001, they were en route with two cars on a relief mission in the northeast of the Democratic Republic of Congo when they came under fatal fire from unknown attackers. Ricardo Munguia, El Salvador. He was working as a water engineer in Afghanistan and traveling with local colleagues on March 27, 2003 when their car was stopped by unknown armed men. He was killed execution style at point blank range while his colleagues were allowed to escape. He was 39 years old. The killing prompted the ICRC to temporarily suspend operations across Afghanistan. Vache Arslanian, Canada. Since 2001, he worked as a logistics coordinator for the ICRC mission in Iraq. He died when he was traveling through Baghdad together with members of the Iraqi Red Crescent on April 8, 2003. Their car accidentally came into the crossfire of fighting in the city Nadisha Yasa Basri Ranmuthu, Sri Lanka. He was killed by unknown attackers on July 22, 2003 when his car was fired upon near the city of Hilla in the south of Baghdad. Emeric Prejeter, Austria. He was an ICRC logistics specialist who was killed by a swarm of killer bees on August 11, 2008 while traveling with a convoy of ICRC trucks carrying construction material for rehabilitation of a surgical health clinic in the area of Jebel Marah, West Darfur, Sudan. Afghanistan. ICRC is active in the Afghanistan conflict areas and has set up 6 physical rehabilitation centers to help landmine victims. Their support extends to the national and international armed forces, civilians, and the armed opposition. They regularly visit detainees under the custody of the Afghan government and the international armed forces, but have also occasionally had access since 2009 to people detained by the Taliban. They have provided basic first aid training and aid kits to both the Afghan security forces and Taliban members because, according to an ICRC spokesperson, ICRC's constitution stipulates that all parties harmed by warfare will be treated as fairly as possible. The International Federation of Red Cross and Red Crescent Societies, IFRC. History. Henry Davison, founding father of the League of Red Cross Societies in 1919, representatives from the National Red Cross Societies of Britain, France, Italy, Japan, and the US came together in Paris to found the League of Red Cross Societies. The original idea was Henry Davison's, then president of the American Red Cross. This move, led by the American Red Cross, expanded the international activities of the Red Cross movement beyond the strict mission of the ICRC to include relief assistance in response to emergency situations which were not caused by war, such as man-made or natural disasters. The ARC already had great disaster relief mission experience extending back to its foundation. The formation of the League, as an additional international Red Cross organization alongside the ICRC, was not without controversy for a number of reasons. The ICRC had, to some extent, valid concerns about a possible rivalry between both organizations. The foundation of the League was seen as an attempt to undermine the leadership position of the ICRC within the movement and to gradually transfer most of its tasks and competencies to a multilateral institution. In addition to that, all founding members of the League were national societies from countries of the Entente or from associated partners of the Entente. The original statutes of the League from May 1919 contained further regulations which gave the five founding societies a privileged status and, due to the efforts of Henry P. Davison, the right to permanently exclude the national Red Cross societies from the countries of the Central Powers, namely Germany, Austria, Hungary, Bulgaria and Turkey, and in addition to that the National Red Cross Society of Russia. These rules were contrary to the Red Cross principles of universality and equality among all national societies, a situation which furthered the concerns of the ICRC. The first relief assistance mission organized by the League was an aid mission for the victims of a famine and subsequent typhus epidemic in Poland only 5 years after its foundation. The League had already issued 47 donation appeals for missions in 34 countries, an impressive indication of the need for this type of Red Cross work. The total sum raised by these appeals reached 685 million Swiss francs, which were used to bring emergency supplies to the victims of famines in Russia, Germany, and Albania, earthquakes in Chile, Persia, Japan, Colombia, Ecuador, Costa Rica, and Turkey, and refugee flows in Greece and Turkey. The first large-scale disaster mission of the League came after the 1923 earthquake in Japan, which killed about 200,000 people and left countless more wounded and without shelter due to the League's coordination. The Red Cross Society of Japan received goods from its sister societies reaching a total worth of about $100 million. Another important new field initiated by the League was the creation of youth Red Cross organizations within the national societies. A stamp from Turkey to support the Red Crescent, 1938, a joint mission of the ICRC and the League in the Russian Civil War from 1917 to 1922 marked the first time the movement was involved in an internal conflict, although still without an explicit mandate from the Geneva Conventions. The League, with support from more than 25 national societies, organized assistance missions and the distribution of food and other aid goods for civil populations affected by hunger and disease. The ICRC worked with the Russian Red Cross Society and later the Society of the Soviet Union, constantly emphasizing the ICRC's neutrality. In 1928, the International Council was founded to coordinate cooperation between the ICRC and the League, a task which was later taken over by the Standing Commission. In the same year, a common statute for the movement was adopted for the first time, defining the respective roles of the ICRC and the League within the movement during the Abyssinian War between Ethiopia and Italy from 1935 to 1936. The League contributed aid supplies worth about 17 million Swiss francs because the Italian fascist regime under Benito Mussolini refused any cooperation with the Red Cross. These goods were delivered solely to Ethiopia during the war. An estimated 29 people lost their lives while being under explicit protection of the Red Cross symbol, most of them due to attacks by the Italian army during the Civil War in Spain from 1936 to 1939. The League once again joined forces with the ICRC with the support of 41 national societies in 1939 on the brink of the Second World War. The League relocated its headquarters from Paris to Geneva to take advantage of Swiss neutrality. Peace Nobel Prize ceremony in 1963. From left to right, Crown Prince Harald of Norway, King Olaf of Norway, ICRC President Leopold Boissier, League Chairman John A. Macaulay. In 1952, the 1928 Common Statute of the Movement was revised for the first time also. The period of decolonization from 1960 to 1970 was marked by a huge jump in the number of recognized National Red Cross and Red Crescent societies. By the end of the 1960s, there were more than 100 societies around the world. On December 10, 1963, the Federation and the ICRC received the Nobel Peace Prize in 1983. The League was renamed to the League of Red Cross and Red Crescent Societies to reflect the growing number of national societies operating under the Red Crescent symbol. 3 years later, the seven basic principles of the movement as adopted in 1965 were incorporated into its statutes. The name of the League was changed again in 1991 to its current official designation, the International Federation of Red Cross and Red Crescent Societies. In 1997, the ICRC and the IFRC signed the Seville Agreement, which further defined the responsibilities of both organizations within the movement. In 2004, the IFRC began its Largest mission to date after the tsunami disaster in South Asia. More than 40 national societies have worked with more than 22,000 volunteers to bring relief to the countless victims left without food and shelter and endangered by the risk of epidemics. Presidents of the IFRC. As of November 2009, the president of the IFRC is Tadateru Kano, Japanese Red Cross. The vice presidents are Anne-Marie Huber-Hott, Switzerland, Osvaldo Manuel Ferrero, Argentina, Abbas Gullet, Kenya, Francesco Rocca, Italy, and Baige Zhao, China. Former presidents until 1977 titled chairman have been 1919-1922, Henry Davison, U.S. 1922-1935, John Barton Payne, U.S. 1935-1938, Kerry Travers Grayson, U.S. 1938-1944, Norman Davis, U.S. 1944-1945, Jean de Meralt, Switzerland, 1945-1950, Basil O'Connor, U.S. 1950-1959, Emil Sandström, Sweden, 1959-1965, John McCauley, Canada, 1965-1977, Jose Barroso Chavez, Mexico, 1977-1981, Adetunji Adeferison, Nigeria, 1981-1987, Enrique de la Mata, Spain, 1987-1997, Mario Enrique Villarol Lander, Venezuela, 1997-2000, Astrid Nøkkelby Heiberg, Norway, 2001-2009, Juan Manuel del Toro y Rivera, Spain, 2009. They have, rather than an effort to arrive at agreement, it was an attempt to answer the question of what did they have in common. Over the past 100 years, those operations and organizational units that were successful as a result, the fundamental principles of the Red Cross and Red Crescent were not revealed, but found, through a deliberate and participative process of discovery that makes it even more important to note that the text that appears under each heading is an integral part of the principle in question and not an interpretation that can vary with time and place. Humanity, the International Red Cross and Red Crescent movement, born of a desire to bring assistance without discrimination to the wounded on the battlefield, endeavors, in its international and national capacity, to prevent and alleviate human suffering wherever it may be found. Its purpose is to protect life and health and to ensure respect for the human being. It promotes mutual understanding, friendship, cooperation, and lasting peace amongst all peoples. Impartiality. It makes no discrimination as to nationality, race, religious beliefs, class, or political opinion. It endeavors to relieve the suffering of individuals, being guided solely by their needs, and to give priority to the most urgent cases of distress. Neutrality. In order to continue to enjoy the confidence of all, the movement may not take sides in hostilities or engage at any time in controversies of a political, racial, religious, or ideological nature. Independence. The movement is independent of the national societies, while auxiliaries in the humanitarian services of their governments and subject to the laws of their respective countries, must always maintain their autonomy so that they may be able at all times to act in accordance with the principles of the movement. Voluntary service. It is a voluntary relief movement not prompted in any manner by desire for gain. Unity. There can be only one Red Cross or one Red Crescent society in any one country. It must be open to all. It must carry on its humanitarian work throughout its territory. Universality. The International Red Cross and Red Crescent movement, in which all societies have equal status and share equal responsibilities and duties in helping each other, is worldwide activities and organization of the International Conference and the Standing Commission. Main article, Standing Commission of the Red Cross and Red Crescent. The International Conference of the Red Cross and Red Crescent, which occurs once every 4 years, is the highest institutional body of the movement. It gathers delegations from all of the national societies as well as from the ICRC, the IFRC, and the signatory states to the Geneva Conventions in between the conferences. The Standing Commission of the Red Cross and Red Crescent acts as the supreme body and supervises implementation of and compliance with the resolution of the conference. In addition, the Standing Commission coordinates the cooperation between the ICRC and the IFRC. It consists of two representatives from the ICRC including its president, two from the IFRC including its president, and five individuals who are elected by the International Conference. The Standing Commission convenes every 6 months on average. Moreover, a convention of the Council of Delegates of the movement takes place every 2 years in the course of the conferences of the General Assembly of the International Federation. and the Council of Delegates plans and coordinates joint activities for the movement activities and organization of the ICRC. The mission of the ICRC and its responsibilities within the movement. The emblem of the International Committee of the Red Cross French, Comité International de la Croix Rouge. The official mission of the ICRC as an impartial, neutral, and independent organization is to stand for the protection of the life and dignity of victims of international and internal armed conflicts according to the 1997 Seville Agreement. It is the lead agency of the movement in conflicts. The core tasks of the committee, which are derived from the Geneva Conventions and its own statutes, are the following: to monitor compliance of warring parties with the Geneva Conventions, to organize nursing and care for those who are wounded on the battlefield, to supervise the treatment of prisoners of war, to help with the search for missing persons in an armed conflict, tracing service to organize protection and care for civil populations, to arbitrate between warring parties in an armed conflict. Legal status and organization. The ICRC is headquartered in the Swiss city of Geneva and has external offices in about 80 countries. It has about 12,000 staff members worldwide, about 800 of them working in its Geneva headquarters, 1,200 expatriates, with about half of them serving as delegates managing its international missions and the other half being specialists like doctors, agronomists, engineers or interpreters, and about 10,000 members of individual national societies working on site. According to Swiss law, the ICRC is defined as a private association. Contrary to popular belief, the ICRC is not a non-governmental organization in the most common sense of the term, nor is it an international organization as it limits its members a process called co-optation to Swiss nationals only. It does not have a policy of open and unrestricted membership for individuals like other legally defined NGOs. The word international in its name does not refer to its membership but to the worldwide scope of its activities as defined by the Geneva Conventions. The ICRC has special privileges and legal immunities in many countries, based on national law in these countries or through agreements between the committee and respective national governments. According to its statutes, it consists of 15 to 25 Swiss citizen members, which it coops for a period of 4 years. There is no limit to the number of terms an individual member can have, although a three-quarters majority of all members is required for re-election after the third term. The leading organs of the ICRC are the Directorate and the Assembly. The Directorate is the executive body of the committee. It consists of a general director and five directors in the areas of operations, human resources, resources and operational support, communication, and international law and cooperation within the movement. The members of the Directorate are appointed by the Assembly to serve for 4 years. The Assembly, consisting of all of the members of the committee, convenes on a regular basis and is responsible for defining aims, guidelines, and strategies and for supervising the financial matters of the committee. The president of the assembly is also the president of the committee as a whole. Furthermore, the assembly elects a five-member assembly council which has the authority to decide on behalf of the full assembly in some matters. The council is also responsible for organizing the assembly meetings and for facilitating communication between the assembly and the directorate due to Geneva's location in the French-speaking part of Switzerland. The ICRC usually acts under its French name Comité International de la Croix Rouge, CICR. The official symbol of the ICRC is the Red Cross on white background with the words Comité International Genève circling the cross. Funding and financial matters. The 2009 budget of the ICRC amounts more than 1 billion Swiss francs. Most of that money comes from the states, including Switzerland in its capacity as the depository state of the Geneva Convention, from national Red Cross societies, the signatory states of the Geneva Conventions, and from international organizations like the European Union. All payments to the ICRC are voluntary and are received as donations based on two types of appeals issued by the committee: an annual headquarters appeal to cover its internal costs and emergency appeals for its individual missions. The ICRC is asking donors for more than 11 billion Swiss francs to fund its work in 2010. Afghanistan is projected to become the ICRC's biggest humanitarian operation at 86 million Swiss francs, an 18% increase over the initial 2009 budget, followed by Iraq 85 million francs and Sudan 76 million francs. The initial 2010 field budget for medical activities of 132 million francs represents an increase of 12 million francs over 2009 activities and organization of the International Federation. The mission of the IFRC and its responsibilities within the movement. Emblem of the IFRC. The IFRC coordinates cooperation between National Red Cross and Red Crescent societies throughout the world and supports the foundation of new national societies in countries where no official society exists on the international stage. The IFRC organizes and leads relief assistance missions after emergencies such as natural disasters, man-made disasters, epidemics, mass refugee flights, and other emergencies. As per the 1997 Seville Agreement, the IFRC is the lead agency of the movement in any emergency situation which does not take place as part of an armed conflict. The IFRC cooperates with the national societies of those countries affected. International Federation as full members or observers, about 25 to 30 regularly work as PNS in other countries. The most active of those are the American Red Cross, the British Red Cross, the German Red Cross, and the Red Cross societies of Sweden and Norway. Another major mission of the IFRC which has gained attention in recent years is its commitment to work towards a codified, worldwide ban on the use of landmines and to bring medical, psychological, and social support for people injured by landmines. The tasks of the IFRC can therefore be summarized as follows: to promote humanitarian principles and values, to provide relief assistance in emergency situations of large magnitude, such as natural disasters, to support the national societies with disaster preparedness through the education of voluntary members and the provision of equipment and relief supplies, to support local health care projects, to support the national societies with youth-related activities, legal status and organization. The IFRC has its headquarters in Geneva. It also runs 5 zone offices: Africa, Americas, Asia Pacific, Europe, Middle East, North Africa, 14 permanent regional offices, and has about 350 delegates in more than 60 delegations around the world. The legal basis for the work of the IFRC is its constitution. The executive body of the IFRC is a secretariat, led by a secretary general. The secretariat is supported by 5 divisions, including Program Services, Humanitarian Values and Humanitarian Diplomacy, National Society and Knowledge Development, and Governance and Management Services. The highest decision-making body of the IFRC is its General Assembly, which convenes every 2 years with delegates from all of the national societies. Among other tasks, the General Assembly elects the Secretary General between the convening of General Assemblies. The Governing Board is the leading body of the IFRC. It has the authority to make decisions for the IFRC in a number of areas. The Governing Board consists of the President and the Vice Presidents of the IFRC, the Chairpersons of the Finance and Youth Commissions, and 20 elected representatives from national societies. The symbol of the IFRC is the combination of the Red Cross left and Red Crescent right on a white background surrounded by a red rectangular frame. Funding and financial matters. The main parts of the budget of the IFRC are funded by contributions from the national societies which are members of the IFRC and through revenues from its investments. The exact amount of contributions from each member society is established by the Finance Commission and approved by the General Assembly. Any additional funding, especially for unforeseen expenses for relief assistance missions, is raised by appeals published by the IFRC and comes for voluntary donations by national societies, governments, other organizations, corporations, and individuals. National societies within the movement. Official recognition of a national society and ambulance owned by the Mexican Red Cross. National Red Cross and Red Crescent societies exist in nearly every country in the world within their home country. They take on the duties and responsibilities of a national relief society as defined by international humanitarian law within the movement. The ICRC is responsible for legally recognizing a relief society as an official National Red Cross or Red Crescent Society. The exact rules for recognition are defined in the statutes of the movement. Article 4 of these statutes contains the conditions for recognition of national societies. In order to be recognized in terms of Article 5, Paragraph 2b as a national society, the society shall meet the following conditions: be constituted on the territory of an independent state where the Geneva Convention for the Amelioration of the Condition of the Wounded and Sick in Armed Forces in the Field is in force, be the only national Red Cross or Red Crescent society of the said state, and be directed by A central body which shall alone be competent to represent it in its dealings with other components of the movement be duly recognized by the legal government of its country on the basis of the Geneva Conventions and of the national legislation as a voluntary aid society, auxiliary to the public authorities in the humanitarian field, have an autonomous status which allows it to operate in conformity with the fundamental principles of the movement, use the name and emblem of the Red Cross or Red Crescent in conformity with the Geneva Conventions, be so organized as to be able to fulfill the tasks defined in its own statutes, including the preparation in peacetime for its statutory tasks in case of armed conflict, extend its activities to the entire territory of the state, recruit its voluntary members and its staff without consideration of race, sex, class, religion or political opinions, adhere to the present statutes, share in the fellowship which unites the components of the movement and cooperate with them, respect the fundamental principles of the movement and be guided in its work by the principles of international humanitarian law. Once a national society has been recognized by the ICRC as a component of the International Red Cross and Red Crescent Movement, the movement, it is in principle admitted to the International Federation of Red Cross and Red Crescent Societies in accordance with the terms defined in the Constitution and Rules of Procedure of the International Federation. There are today 189 national societies recognized within the movement and which are members of the International Federation. The most recent national societies to have been recognized within the movement are the Maldives Red Crescent Society, 9 November 2011, the Cyprus Red Cross Society and the South Sudan Red Cross Society, 12 November 2013. Activities of national societies on a national and international stage. Despite formal independence regarding its organizational structure and work, each national society is still bound by the laws of its home country. In many countries, national Red Cross and Red Crescent societies enjoy exceptional privileges due to agreements with their governments or specific Red Cross laws granting full independence as required by the international movement. The duties and responsibilities of a national society as defined by international humanitarian law and the statutes of the movement include humanitarian aid in armed conflicts and emergency crises such as natural disasters, through activities such as restoring family links.